Hi, everyone. Welcome. I'm immigration attorney John Kusravi of the JQK Immigration Law Firm here with my wonderful associate, Anya Sergiva, here to talk about some important news regarding U.S. immigration and some topics that we deal with a lot. Anya, thank you for coming on again.
Thank you so much, John. Hi, everyone. Today, we're going to talk about wheat, so please stay with us till the end.
Yeah, we're talking about marijuana effects. We're going to actually start with the vaccine and testing requirement for travelers coming to the United States. And then we're going to end it off with information about sponsorship, financial sponsorship. When you're an affidavit support sponsor, what responsibilities are and how they stay. So definitely stay tuned with that. But before starting, if you're new or if you're regular, please like, subscribe, and leave a comment. That helps promote the channel so people can learn more about this information. So let's jump into it, Anya. What is the new testing requirement for people visiting the United States or not even visiting, people who live here?
Right. So this is probably not directly immigration law related topic, but it's very important. We get this inquiry from our clients all the time. So CDC, what it's called, the Center of, I forgot
Disease
what.
Disease Control, yeah.
Disease Control, right. Yes, they just updated their order regarding vaccine testing requirements for any international travel into the United States. Mm-hmm. So the new requirement is enforced since yesterday. Today, it's December 7th. We're recording this episode. So from December 6th, there is this new requirement, and I will go in into more detail about that. So generally, anyone 2 years or older traveling into the United States would need to get a negative COVID test result for conducted not later than one calendar day before the flight's departure from the foreign country. So what has changed, right? Before this order, testing requirement depending on the status, immigration status, right? And on the vaccination status. Now, it doesn't depend on anything. Everyone, U.S. citizens, lawful permanent residents, people traveling to the United States on immigrant visas, right? People traveling on to the United States on non-immigrant visas, including tourist visas. So anyone traveling into the United States now, they would need to get this test result, right? Kids younger than 2 years of age, they're exempt from this requirement. There are a couple more exemptions. Right. But for example, for military members and their dependents, yes, if they travel on this U.S. military aircrafts and so on. Right. So what I want to mention here, a couple important points. it can be paper or digital. Right. This nothing has changed for that. Right. It has to be viral tests. Very important, too. It means that only like live test result will be accepted. What it means, for example, there's such a test, it's called antibodies test, right? This test will not be accepted, right? But antigen test will be accepted and PCR test will still be accepted, all right? So they made into the time frame, they made into one calendar day, right? So this is not 24 hours as it used to be before, like 72 hours, for example, right? It used to be before. Now it's more flexible. So, for example, if you're traveling to the United States, right, on, say, Wednesday, right, you can present the test the specimen was taken on Tuesday within any time on Tuesday. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't have to be like exactly 24 hours. It has to be one calendar, not more than one calendar day. Okay. Yes. Also, if the person recently recovered from COVID, right, they don't have to provide negative test result, right? They can provide positive test result, right, taken no more than 90 calendar days before the flight's departure, and a letter from the doctor saying that they're good to travel. Okay. Yes. So there are two things. If you recently recovered from COVID, then you can provide this your positive test taken within not more than 90 days and the letter from your doctor. Or if you were not sick with COVID, you would need to provide the negative test result. Again, it's for everyone, lawful permanent residents, U.S. citizens, tourists, anyone traveling into the United States, regardless of vaccination status. Regardless of vaccination status.
So that creates a lot of hassle if you're trying to travel. So we'll see how long this situation hopefully ends sooner, because this international travel has gotten a big nuisance with all this kind of stuff.
Right. It's gonna be a problem. For example, it depends on what country you're traveling from to the United States, into the United States, right? Yeah. And some countries might not be have this test facilities quick enough to provide this results, right?
What so,
but
nightmare.
this what we have, and
that's that. So I hope that information helped. It's the most recent information we have. Now, the next thing we wanted to talk about is the marijuana issue, because, you know, in the United States, so many of the local states, and for those unaware, international audience, the United States, America is a country, but within it, there's 50 different states that are essentially 50 sub-countries that have their own rules and stuff. Many of them have made marijuana, weed, or has very different names, legalized. And so they won't hassle you about it. And you can even go buy it in the store and sometimes pay with a credit card even. But they're still illegal under federal law. And U.S. immigration law is federal law. So if you're an immigrant, a person who does not have a U.S. citizenship, whether you're a visitor here on work visa, tourist visa, or even a green card holder, marijuana is completely illegal and a felony, essentially. So that's something that becomes a big problem that we run into a lot when people aren't aware of this. They assume because the state of California or the state of whatever says it's fine, they think it's okay for them. And we see these kind of issues pop up at all stages, not just from the beginning to even applying for citizenship. So that's a big headache that we see popping up a lot in our cases, Anya, more and more every day.
Right. So everyone has to be aware of this, right? Yeah. So if it was legalized or decriminalized on the state level, it's still a federal offense, mm-hmm. under U.S. federal laws. And U.S. federal laws govern immigration. Okay, yeah. So when this usually pops up, right? At the naturalization stage, right? If you're, for example, if you're a lawful permanent resident coming back to the United States from overseas, right, mm-hmm. At the border, right,
yeah.
On the adjustment stage, if you're immigrating into the United States and you are, for example, having your immigrant visa interview at the embassy, right, medical exam part, when your medical provider asks you this kind of questions about using marijuana.
Yeah.
So not just use, everything covered. Even people who work in this industry, yeah. Right? Again, in the states where marijuana is legal or decriminalized, it might cause problems. So
yeah, that's
the best advice is just to avoid any yeah. encounter with marijuana.
Hey, there was a famous case in this guy on the news about it. I remember he had called my office up and I said, you know, we can't help you. And he went, the only reason I could talk about it is because he went public with it. But it was a researcher doing serious research on marijuana. So and he thought it was legal because he was like a well-known scientist in the field and wasn't a user at all. He was just doing technical stuff. But they denied his case and he's banned because essentially he was partaking in it. Now, even using is better than participating in the sale and distribution, even if it's legal or is research. And so it's something you have to be very careful on. But, you know, there is an exception for small amounts under the Immigration Nationality Act, Section 212. There's a small amount exception, but that gets more nuanced. I think it's like 30 grams possession or less. I got to double check that. But sometimes you might get arrested and the arrest report doesn't have the exact amount. And they'll say, well, we don't know how much it was. We're just going to hold it in the worst case. That was more than that minimum amount. But one thing that we've recently seen is with the embassies and how they deal with it is a little more nuanced. Because obviously it could be considered, depending on, you know, proving the case, that it might be against the law in the country that you're in or wherever you are using marijuana. But the embassies themselves, what we're seeing is that they don't necessarily deny a case if someone says, you know, they're a marijuana user. What in these cases, before their embassy interview for a green card in particular, for a fiancé visa, there's a medical checkup that happens with a panel physician. And that time they know this, or they do a test on, they figure it out, and they tell the embassy, and the embassy refuses the visa, but refusal is not a straight up denial. And the embassies, most of the time, won't deny the case and say there's criminal activity. They can, but they rarely do that. Apparently, it's a lot of work to do something like that. But they hit him on a medical situation saying you're an addict under INA 212, I think A2 or something like that. And because you're an addict, we need to make sure you're healthy before you can enter the United States. And they say, well, come back in a year, do another panel physician a year, and we might do random drug tests even throughout that time. And if you come up clear next time, then you're okay. So it's a weird situation how they deal with it differently in different places. That person may have problems applying for citizenship later even. But it is possible to get through consular processing for an immigrant visa green card case in those scenarios. But you never know. It depends on how the consular officer is going to deal with the case. So, you know, you shouldn't use marijuana, you especially in the immigration context, it could be a problem. But it's on all aspects, as you mentioned, where it come up at the border, at the embassy, at the panel position, adjustment, at naturalization, every step it could be hit. And it's going to be a problem even if you're in a country where, you know, marijuana is legalized, people use it in a foreign country, it can still pop up for U.S. immigration issues. So something to be very careful of.
Right. And conviction is not necessary, right?
Yeah.
Just like heaven plant at your balcony. This is enough.
Yeah. Right?
This is enough. So please be very careful with that. If you're using marijuana or you have some encounter with marijuana and you have pending immigration case, you must talk with immigration attorney.
Yeah, get some good help on that to see what's going on. And so, you know, the next thing I wanted to talk about is the affidavit support requirement, a special nuanced version of it. So just some background, if you're going to do a family-based immigration case where you're applying for siblings, parents, children, all that kind of stuff, there's going to be a part where you need to file an affidavit of support to say you're financially going to support that foreign person who's going to get a green card, their family. And sometimes if you're the petitioner, the main person requesting it for the foreign family member doesn't make enough money, you might get a joint sponsor or a household member from I-64A in that case to submit it. And then what happens, sometimes families have falling outs, they have divorces, and they're like, well, I don't want to support this person anymore. I don't want to be on the hook, because the affidavit of support means that if they go to the hospital could ask you for the money. If they get food stamps or things they're not supposed to get because of their status, they could come after you and get the money. So there's a lot of financial consequences that could happen. The foreign person could even sue the sponsor and say, listen, you need to pay me $2,000, $3,000 a month according to the I-64 that you signed. So it's a lot of financial responsibilities. Rarely ever does come down to it, but it happens, and we get these calls. And you know, the divorce context is where it comes out. People start hating each other and they don't want to do it. And Anya, so Anya, what is the requirement of the affidavit support in the sense that when could you get out of it and how could you get out of it?
Well, this is the contract, right?
Yeah.
Contract between the sponsor and the government. U.S. Exactly. government, right? Saying that the sponsor will take all the financial responsibility for the intended immigrant, right? And there are a couple of ways that sponsor can get out. For example, when the immigrant becomes a U.S. citizen, mm-hmm. this is the first thing, right? If the immigrant died, so of course, understandably, right? If a person is no longer a permanent resident and they lost this permanent resident status, mm-hmm. right? If they worked if for like 40 credits or quarters,
40 or something like that, yeah, yeah.
Right, which is
years, then I can't remember, 10 years, right?
Yeah, something years. Like that, something like that, yes. And they have enough of this like social security payments that they made during this time, yeah. Right? And there's one more thing, about removal proceedings, right?
Yeah, they've been found remove and lose a green card status. So as you said, like that this is a contract with the U.S. government. So it's not like they won't back out of the contract. It's not with the foreign person for their support. So there's no way out of it. But the thing is, when you mentioned the first one, when the foreign person becomes a citizen, this is incentive, because people sometimes in these contexts, they really start hating each other and they don't want to help. But sometimes like, listen, help the person get their citizenship. The sooner they get the citizenship, the sooner that your responsibilities go away. So trying to make it more difficult for them to keep their green card sometimes can work against you, because they'll keep their green card and they can force you to get more money, go to court, even sue you and get that money.
Right. So there is no really such a thing as withdrawal. You cannot withdraw this application, this form, right? You cannot, unless, as I said, the person became a U.S. citizen or they lost their status and so on. Right, there's no such a thing as just withdrawal.
So once at most, if they just sent it in, the case is still pending, maybe they could pull it out. But once a person's green card is issued, that's done. The contract is settled and you're on the hook for the I-864 after the support.
Yes, very important. Very important thing. That's right. Before the case is not done yet, yes, you might still do something with it. But once the person receives the green card, that's it.
Well, thank you so much, Anya. This is a thing. All these issues that we talk about today pop up all the time. People call us all the time where they're like, I don't want to be part of this. Or they want to know what the responsibilities are of the joint sponsor because their friend or relative said, hey, could you do this? And they're kind of worried about it. Now, typically, these problems don't happen and nobody ever needs to pay out or anything for the affidavit support. But, you know, it's life. There's a million people getting green cards every year. I think half of them at least are family cases. So statistically, this stuff does come up. So it's good to go with your open eyes. Now, if my sister married somebody and she wanted me to be a finance support, I'd probably do it just because it's, you know, so my sister. But sometimes, you know, relationships are always different in different families and different friendships. But it's good to know what the facts are. Thank you so much. Go ahead.
Yes, I have a question. So you mentioned that the immigrant can potentially sue the sponsor to provide like financial support under this under the affidavit of support. Is this the case?
Yeah, there's an attorney actually in Washington State that's most of his business immigration is doing these lawsuits because when the sponsors won't pay up, they go to court and they get an order that forces them to pay up under this contract. So it's like civil litigation. And there's not much case law.
Is this they're suing each other? Because I understand, again, this is the contract between the government and the sponsor.
Yeah.
Right? So how the immigrant can potentially sue the sponsor under this circumstance?
It goes to state law, and I haven't done lawsuits, but I think it would be something like they're the beneficiary of this, so they have like their party at stake and they could force it. Because they said they're going to support this person for this amount of money, and they're on the hook for, you know, if you just marry somebody, you know, $22,000, maybe $300 a month or something like that. So they just go to state court and they sue on it, and it's an easy win for the most part because there've been cases where people appeal. They say, you know, my spouse was cheating on me, or they only married me because they want to get a green card, and the judges are like, no, this is it. We don't believe that unless USCIS, I guess, pulls a fraud statute and you know, takes away that they sue all the time. I think who's the person? He's in Washington State. He does a lot of litigation on this. It's like his main practice area. But they win frequently. Even appeals that have happened, the next level appeals, the courts have said, yeah, this is it. Now, they could be, you know, higher end federal appeals that happen that kind of get their case law on this. But for the most part, that's it. You sue and you get it.
So they get like basically some kind of alimony or something like that, right?
Yes, an additional alimony. Now, some people in their prenuptial agreement say, well, if I have to pay this, then you cancel it out. You know, there's just not enough litigation and public litigation that they probably settle this kind of stuff for us to know exactly how that works out. So the actual case law and court work for it is not fully clear, but there are a lot of, you know, first level cases where people sue and they get it. It's pretty consistent that they get it. But whether prenuptial agreements could fully get you out of it. Because, like, there's two things. One is you're going to support the foreign person and give them money on a continuous basis. That's one aspect. But there's the contract with the government, which is like, I went to the hospital, it cost $50,000. Somebody's got to pay for it. That's you can't get out of, you know. But so there's like two aspects to that come with it. So you can't, you know, sign a prenuptial agreement. Maybe you could sign an agreement with the spouse that says, if I have to pay for you for the advocate support, you'll indemnify me, pay me back. There just haven't been case law that I can see where it's actually happened if you went to court. So we don't really know how this works out. They probably always settle out of court to avoid all the lawyers' costs. So that's going to cost a bunch of money going to court about this. But it is an area that's kind of in flux and unknown, other than you probably can't get it if you need it.
Yes, this is a very interesting point to know. So once you sign an affidavit of support, right, not only government can come after you, right, but your spouse or the one who you're signing these papers for.
Exactly. Whoever you sponsored could get it. So it's just, you know, buyer beware, signer beware that these responses come in. With our firm, when we have sponsors and joint sponsors, it's in our contract and these releases that specify what these responsibilities are. So people go in with their eyes open. There's no surprises. Last thing we want a couple of years from now, someone say, hey, you didn't tell me this. Like, no, you did. We had this release. So you went in fully aware. And usually, you know, it sounds kind of scary, but people do it. Very rarely a problem, but again, it could pop up.
Yes, and one last thing that I want to mention. The affidavit of support asks about the household size, right?
Yeah.
And this household size, if you sponsored someone previously, you need to, if this person is still a lawful permanent resident and didn't become a US citizen yet, right? You need to include them in this in the future affidavit of support.
Yeah, that becomes really important. We had a case recently where a guy sponsored a spouse and they got divorced and he sponsored a new spouse. And we're like, well, what happened is the family size is going to be bigger and it's required more income. He barely made it. But he's like, no, my previous spouse got her citizenship. She's a citizen now. So, okay, household size was smaller. So the minimum amount of money they need to make to do an affidavit support was good. So that fixed it up. Abanya, thank you so much for coming. If y'all haven't already, please like and subscribe to get more information on this kind of pop-ups when we're posting these kind of things. And if you want to schedule a consultation, just email our office directly at info@jqklaw.com. And Anya and I will be happy to help you out. Look forward to it. Thanks, Anya.
Thank you. Thank you, John. Thank you, everyone, for watching.
We'll see y'all soon.
Bye-bye.